looks at history and particular social and historical context of philosophy, and it actually doesn't need corruption for the explanation. What I'm going to say doesn't involve corruption. It involves an understanding of the process of working of capitalism in particular social and historical conditions that are independent of the individual will. The second point that my presentation is more focused on ways forward, because this was the question that was asked of me to do. But in order to do that, to look at ways forward, I need to explain what my narrative of the crisis is. So, for the time being, we are going to be in this slide, because my slide presentation is very long, and I'm going to have a brief summary of the first part, and then we are going to look at some data, and then try to look at ways forward. Okay, my argument about Mozambican crisis is that Mozambican crisis is shows the limits of dependent capitalism. And what is that? Of dependent capitalism that in a way is a latecomer kind of capitalism. Mozambique became independent in 75 due to colonialism. The national bourgeoisie classes were underdeveloped at the time, and in the first decade of independence, the Mozambican government didn't support the process of developing a national bourgeoisie. Actually, there was a slogan in Mozambique that said, "We should kill the crocodile when it's still in the egg," a mistake that Mugabe didn't do. And so he was overthrown by the crocodile, I think. But okay, the slogan in Mozambique was "You should kill the crocodile while it's in the egg," and it meant we should prevent the national bourgeoisie from developing rather than having to deal with it later. So the combination of these two elements led to a very underdeveloped capitalist class in Mozambique. Actually, I'm not sure we can talk about a national capitalist class in the in the mid-80s or late 80s. So the crisis in Mozambique, the economic crisis in Mozambique of the 80s led to Mozambique joining the Bretton Woods institutions, negotiating a structural adjustment and stabilization program, which started being implemented from 1987. And the idea at that point, the question at that point was, what we have to do in Mozambique is to unleash the private sector. There was an interesting debate between the then Minister of Finance in Mozambique, Majid Osman, with the chief economist of the World Bank in Mozambique. When the World Bank was presenting the 1989 report on sub-Saharan Africa, and the World Bank guy was saying that we need to unleash the private sector, and Majid Osman said, okay, but we do have a leash, but no dog at the end of it, so what do you unleash? And so the question that came about was, what do you do when you live in a dominantly neoliberal economic framework that is being put forward not by the World Bank and the IMF only, as it is often said, but actually by big capital? You know that in the 70s and 80s there was a big fall in the rate of profits of capital in the world. There was, in the 70s there was a very strong labor movement in capitalist societies, and it was the task of capitalism to respond to that, to increase the rate of profits and to kill the labor movement. That was very well done in countries like the UK by Margaret Thatcher, in countries like the United States by Ronald Reagan, and so on. So it was a movement of capital. It was restructuring of global capital, not only the World Bank and the IMF as ideologues of something that we don't understand. So in that particular world, what would happen to a country like Mozambique if you just open? The apartheid was coming to an end. The sanctions would be removed. South African capitalists would globalize, and the first step to globalization would be the region. Foreign capital would come into Mozambique, and what would happen? So the first response to that was a very interesting speech done by Herman Cruza in 1986 in one hotel in Maputo, 86 or 87, in which he said what I call the Mozambican Capitalist Manifesto. And the Capitalist Manifesto had very interesting points in there. You may disagree with it, but what I'm saying is an interesting approach to the problem. Basically, what it said is that imperialism is on the offensive. We are going to lose the sovereignty of our resources. And in order to protect our resources, we need to have the guardians. And the guardians are going to be a national bourgeoisie. Now, you can ask the question, why not the state? Right? So the resources are with the state, why not strengthen the state? But the answer was, we need the national bourgeoisie. Now, the point is, where would this national bourgeoisie come from? It has to be a patriotic one, so the sovereignty is protected. Who is the owner of patriotism in Mozambique? Frelimo. So it has to come from that group. The people involved politically with Frelimo, the managers of state-owned companies, and so on and so forth. That was the group. Now, the question is, where is capital going to come from? The Mozambican economy is in a crisis, can't finance the development of a national bourgeoisie. Where is capital going to come from? It has to come from abroad. So we need to link with international capital. And then the third thing is, what are the resources that we have? What is the main resource that we have in the country that can be used for that process? And that resource is the state. The state is national. The state owns, for historical reasons, the state owned a very large share of companies, shares in companies abandoned after independence, control land, mineral resources, and so on. So the state was the provider of the capacity to engage in this process of forming a national bourgeoisie. There is nothing here in this description I'm giving you that can be called corruption. This is not different from any process of primitive capital accumulation that took place in Europe, in the United States, and so on. So, what happened then was a very quick process of creating a new national bourgeoisie in different stages with mistakes in the process and also with different pressures from different sides. The first thing that was done was the privatization process. Not of 800 state companies, but about 1,500 actually, and assets in 1,500 more. Mozambique was actually referred as the country in Africa that privatized quicker. The decision about allocation of companies to Mozambicans did come from the World Bank. Actually, at the time, I was an advisor to the Minister of Industry and Energy, and my particular task as advisor was to help him with the privatization process. And my help was very unwelcome because my first question is, why do we need to privatize? And my second question is, why do we need to privatize in this particular manner? And so I was given other tasks, but also, and the first and most welcome task I was given was to go abroad to study, to do my postgrad studies. So it was very good in that sense. But the question is that it was from internal debates that these ideas came. And they didn't came because people were groups, but because there was this process of forming a national bourgeoisie, a national capitalist class,